Americans, the greatest generation, answered the call to defend our freedom. From big cities to small towns and farms across this nation, these young men and women put their lives on hold and marched off to uncertain futures. 4 years of battles across the world in little-known places like Guadalcanal, Iwo Jima, Wake Island, Midway, as well as the shores of Normandy, the Ardennes Forest, Alamein, and eventually into Berlin. Many Americans did not come home. They paid the ultimate sacrifice to protect the liberties and rights of our fellow countrymen. For most of the veterans that did make it back home, they did not get ticker tape parades or big celebrations. They simply arrived back home, threw their duffel bags in their basements, and began to build America and rebuild their lives.
So tell me about your day so far. Welcome to your memorial.
I think this is a wonderful thing. I'm sorry it never started before for a lot of veterans that are not here today. We're down to only a million and a half out of 15 million that were in service. And I think you owe it to them to build this thing. I think it's beautiful.
I was proud to serve in the service, and I'm so proud of you guys of being here. It's just unbelievable, and I'm so grateful, and this is what America is all about, and God bless you all.
Well, I got out of high school in 1943. I was 17, and I had two brothers already in the service, and my dad had to sign the application. And I didn't think he would do it, but he did. Because in those days, everybody was involved.
World War II men and women of the Kansas Honor Flight, basically we have sent the bulk of them.
There's 43 states involved in this. It's a national network. And we're just one of them, Kansas Honor Flights. And our hub is in Hutchinson. That's where they do all the logistics, all the flight scheduling, and they have one tough job. Our job here in this Sedgwick County area here is just to raise the funds to get them over there. I went in 2011, and I made a lot of trips all over, but that trip was a trip of a lifetime.
It's refreshing to be in their presence, to win. Especially myself, I'll have the Honor Flight logo on my shirt, and they'll see that, and they'll always say, "I went on that flight." And the grin goes from ear to ear. And when we're around other people, they will always, always say, "It's a trip of a lifetime." Almost verbatim, everyone will say just that. That's the best way to describe it. Because they get to go with their buddies, the men who served in their time period. And when they go back to Washington, D.C., and when they get off that airplane, and they're honored by the military, and that evening, the military, they give them a banquet with full military honors.
I talk to people and ask them, if you have anybody in your family in World War II, or even the Korean or the Vietnam War, and they would say, "Oh yeah, my uncle or my son, my grandfather, whoever." And I said, "Well, have they been on the trip?" And someone would say, well, I don't know, but let me find out. Or they would say, oh, yeah, but he doesn't want to go. And then occasionally we were running somebody who hadn't even heard about us flying. You know, the vets fly free of everything. And that trip, to all of them, as they come home, you ask them. And I heard this from some other people, some other vets that already have gone. That trip was the best that we ever had. It was a trip of a lifetime. It's the closing chapter of their lives.
Let's take care of these men and women while we can. A lot of these folks are 95 plus years old, and we're losing them pretty fast. But what's ironic, we're losing our Vietnam War veterans faster than we're losing World War II veterans right now. Agent Orange and suicides. That's a terrible thing to experience. So we need to honor them. So when the Vietnam War veteran, at the end of this year, the way we plan things, we're trying to send 2 flights per month, and we're going to send 10 flights out. That's our goal. We're trying to raise $198,000 to do that. And with everyone's help, we can accomplish this mission this year. That's our goal.
Hopefully, with the funding, we can start getting the Korean guys because you know that was that's a forgotten war, but we still got troops up there on 38th parallel, and finally, you know, the Vietnam guys, we want to give them the welcome they did not get.
It was the worst of wars. A war fought in a mountainous, rocky, treacherous terrain. With extremes of heat and cold, snow and ice, mud, stink, and choking dust. And all in an obscure place on the fringes of the geography books.
To me, the Korean War was the most difficult conflict in American history.
The Korean War, a fight many feared to be the beginning of World War III, a monumental conflict marked by panic and moments of stunning courage, by retreat and advance, misunderstanding and blunder.
Korea, in the summer of 1950 and into the fall, was the dirtiest, nastiest place I've ever been in.
In 3 years of fighting in Korea, nearly as many Americans will die as in a decade of battle in Vietnam. On all sides, military and civilian, there will be nearly 4 million dead. It is the defining struggle of the Cold War, a battleground on which the use of nuclear weapons is a frightening possibility. And it is the first and only time Western and communist superpowers have squared off on the battlefield, head to head and hand to hand.
Personal death is a small thing. Defending the country is a big thing. We must ensure the happiness of the people. I was not afraid of dying.
Today, the Korean War is largely forgotten, like a nightmare so gruesome it cannot survive the memory of mourning. Forgotten, except to those who were really there.
I hadn't had a bath in 10 days. We lived like cavemen. My friend told me, I know we're going to heaven because now we're spending our time in hell.
They say that, and any combat vet will tell you the same thing, that the worst time when you're in combat is when you first get there and when you're getting ready to leave. It's too many friends of mine left behind. People equate bravery with doing something fantastic. That's not what it is. Bravery is realizing the fact that you're going to go into something that is stacked against you, but you go anyway.
I truly believe that God has a plan for all of us. And I enlisted in the Army to avoid the Marines. And the week that I arrived in Vietnam, they sent the Marines home, and my unit replaced the Marines on the DMZ. And our ambush unit got ambushed because a sergeant in charge, who was not an infantryman, argued with me about how to set up the ambush, and he said it looking away from the trail. And sure enough, luckily none of us were injured or even a scratch on us. California looks so different. I looked at it different, it smelled different, the people were different, the cars were different, the attitudes were different, the music was different. It was a completely new world to me in a year's time. It made me a better person. I grew up in a hurry. I left when I was 21. I was 45 years old. You know, you walk through an airport now, and you see soldiers coming back from wherever. Everybody stands up and applauds them. We didn't get any of them.
And I got to the San Francisco airport, and I couldn't go home. I didn't know where to go, but I couldn't go home. And so I stayed in the airport for 10 days. The USO had a club upstairs where the guys going over to Vietnam would wait on their flights, and they had, I think, some ping pong tables and TVs and some writing stationery and stuff. And I just stayed in the San Francisco airport for 10 days talking to the guys leaving for Vietnam, because I couldn't relate to going home. I couldn't relate to being back in the United States. I felt like I really wanted just to go back to Nam and be with the guys that understood where I was, because I couldn't understand what was going on here any longer. Things didn't make any sense.
I left in March of 69, and one of the people who came in to replace my group of nurses was a lady named Sharon Lane. And Sharon Lane was killed at Chulai at the 312th Evac Hospital, which was where our hospital used to be before we moved, ours being a mobile unit. And she was killed on the ward by incoming rocket that kills a number of the patients too, and I believe they were Vietnamese patients, I'm not sure. But she was only in country a very short time. But every time I see the wall or see her name, it brings it a little bit home. I support very strongly the Women's Memorial, because officially you may not have been categorized that way, but you were subject to all of the hazards that everybody else was. Snipers, gunfire, rockets, mortars. More than a few nights I've spent in flak jacket and helmet. More than a few of my people have been shot at.
When I got back, I landed in San Francisco at SFO, at the airport there in San Francisco. And I was not aware of anything that was going on. I just got off the airport, off the airplane, and there were a whole line of protesters. What is this all about? I had no idea. And I got spit on, I cannot tell you how many times. I absolutely did not understand what was going on.
And when we landed in Fort Lewis, they said, here's your orders. You are now ETS'd. You're on your own. I was literally plucked out of the bush and put right back into civilization. And when I got there, they told me, don't wear your uniform. You are not well-liked. You're baby killers.
See, we fought a guerrilla warfare. You know, our job was to find the enemy and keep them from bunching up. So it was a totally different type of war. When I look back, I think, God, you know, just one mistake. You know, you lose guys or what have you, so you really had to be on your toes. Some of the things you see or you do at 18, never dreamed you'd go through something like that. This is probably what hurts me the most. When I came home, and I was walking through the airport from the plane area to wherever they call it, the runway? Not the runway, but anyway, when I was walking home, people just moved to the side. It was like, I thought, well, why do you fear me? You know? But they just moved. Didn't acknowledge. Didn't look at you.
A special group of U.S. military veterans returned home to Kansas today as the final honor flight of the spring came in for a landing. It wasn't just any honor flight returning to Eisenhower National Airport. This was the 50th one. And with the 4th of July just days away, this welcome home was even more special. The almost 40 veterans on the trip spent 2 days in Washington, D.C., touring all of the major memorials. For many, it was a trip of a lifetime.
I was selected to represent the Marine Corps at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, placing a wreath there. All five branches was represented.
Among those on hand to welcome them back was Senator Jerry Moran. He's used to welcoming the veterans to the nation's capital. This was the first time on the back end of the trip.
My dad was a World War II veteran. I remember he went on an honor flight. I remember my mother telling me the best part that your dad thought about the whole trip was when he came home and was welcomed by Kansans. They rolled out the red carpet and there was a band.
Family members of the veterans say their loved ones have been looking forward to the trip for months.
This is just something he wanted to experience. He needed to see that Vietnam wall. That was part of his bucket list.
Thank you.
He was getting old and paunchy, and his hair was falling fast. And he sat around the Legion telling stories of the past, of a war that he had fought in, and the deeds that he had done, in his exploits with his buddies. They were heroes, every one. And though sometimes to his neighbors his tales became a joke, all his Legion buddies listened, for they knew whereof he spoke. But we'll hear his tales no longer, for old Bill has passed away. The world's a little poorer, for a soldier died today. He will not be mourned by many, just his children and his wife. For he lived an ordinary and quite uneventful life. He held a job and raised a family, quietly going his own way. And the world won't note his passing, though a soldier died today. When politicians leave this earth, their bodies lie in state, while thousands note their passing and proclaim that they were great. Papers tell their whole life stories from the time that they were young. But the passing of a soldier goes unnoticed and unsung. Is the greatest contribution to the welfare of our land a guy who breaks his promise and cons his fellow man? Or the ordinary fellow who in times of war and strife goes off to serve his country and offers up his life? A politician's stipend and the style in which he lives are sometimes disproportionate to the service that he gives, while the ordinary soldier who has offered up his all is paid off with a medal, perhaps a pension, small. It's so easy to forget them, for it was so long ago that the old Bills of our country went to battle. But we know it was not the politicians with their compromises and ploys who won for us the freedom that our country now enjoys. Should you find yourself in danger with your enemies at hand, would you want a politician with his ever-shifting stand? Or would you prefer a soldier who has sworn to defend his home, his kin and country, and would fight until the end? He was just a common soldier, and his ranks are growing thin. But his presence should remind us we may need his like again. For when countries are in conflict, then we find the soldier's part is to clean up all the troubles that the politicians started. If we cannot do him honor while he's here to hear the praise, then at least let's give him homage at the ending of his days. Perhaps just a simple headline in a paper that would say, "Our country is in mourning, for a soldier died today."
Shut the door. You crossed the sea to fight a war. You didn't know just what would happen to you. Stepped in the dirt, boots on the ground. in gunfire was the only